My name is Keith Oliver. I'm 63 years of age, and I'm a retired primary school head teacher living in Canterbury. Yes, my book is called Dear Alzheimer's, A Diary of Living with Dementia, and it was published in April 2019 by Jessica Kingsley Publishing. And it's a story of my life over the last 7 or 8 years, told through a diary format, which was written in a reflective journal style, alongside some letters which I wrote to this character called Alzheimer's, which is really the disease that lurks inside my head, because I was diagnosed with Alzheimer's 8 years ago, age 55. And then finally it has some items of poetry that I wrote, and a film script that I wrote, and an interview with some Canterbury Christchurch University and University of Kent students. Next week, on May the 17th, I'm doing a talk at Waterstones Bookshop in Canterbury at 6:30, and the idea is to promote and launch the book, even though the book was out a month ago. And currently there are approximately 90 tickets sold. It'd be lovely to pass the 100 mark, but the idea is that people pay £3 and there'll be wine and refreshments, and then that £3 is reimbursed when people buy a book. And what I'll do is I'll talk about the book and talk about my life for a period of time, and then there'll be a question and answer, and then there'll be opportunity to buy the book and for me to sign it and for people to mingle and chat. Alzheimer's is probably the biggest health threat to this society that we live in. Currently, the best guess is that we've got 850,000 people living with it, of whom over 40,000 are youngsters like myself. That means that their onset of their dementia was before the age of 65. I know people in their 30s who have dementia as well. Very, very rare, but it does happen. And the cost to the individuals and the cost to the society, not just financially, but by way of the impact the disease has on people, is enormous. And for too long, it has been swept under the carpet and has been disregarded by health, social care, and politicians. That now has got to stop. And hopefully my book will help contribute towards awareness raising, and in turn, further action to support people living with dementia and carers who live with us. Probably the best way to answer that is to talk about the fact that, using metaphors to help, in my case, it's like driving along a road in the fog, whereby sometimes the fog is pea soup thick, sometimes it's misty, sometimes the fog lifts and it's clear. That's what a normal day will be like for me with Alzheimer's. It's like living in a fog. And also, it's also a bit like having an image in your mind and somebody's got a hole punch and punched holes in it. Sometimes there are a few holes, so the image is quite intact and the memory is reasonably intact. Sometimes it's very, very obscured and you can't decipher what you're looking at. There's two ways of trying to express what living with, in my case, Alzheimer's, or to make plain really that dementia is an umbrella term. And there are approximately 70 to 80 different diseases and conditions that form part of dementia. I've got the most common type, which is Alzheimer's, which affects approximately 70% of those living with dementia. Also, it does affect the memory, but it affects more than the memory. It affects your spatial awareness, it affects your ability to concentrate, it affects your ability to engage with other people. It affects your balance, your mobility, your ability to eat and to manage your life generally. And everybody has problems with memory. Everybody forgets things. Everybody has some of the problems that I experience. But if you imagine a spectrum from 1 to 10, people without dementia would experience those things at about 0.2 or 3 probably. I experience them at 0.8, 9 and 10. Yeah, there's approximately 90 different types of condition and disease that form part of dementia. For example, there's frontal temporal dementia, which just affects the front of the brain. There's vascular dementia, which is quite a common one. There's dementia with Lewy bodies, which means people have hallucinations. There's Parkinson's dementia. There's a dementia linked to alcohol, too much alcohol consumption, called Korsakoff's. There's an enormous range of them. And so when people talk about dementia, they often think Alzheimer's, because that's the most common, but it is only 70%. Just to talk a bit more about what motivated me to write the book, really, because I had previously worked on a joint project with people with dementia, and we published a book called Welcome to Our World back in 2014, which was supported by some students at Kent University. Then in 2016, I self-published another book on my own called Walk the Walk, Talk the Talk. Both those books raised money for the Alzheimer's Society and have raised currently approximately £14,000 for the society. I didn't make any money from those and don't wish to make money from them. Then in 2017, I was approached by a publisher to see if I would sit down and write a book for them. And I hadn't considered writing another one. So with their encouragement, I decided to write one, but I wanted it to be for charity again. So this particular book is raising funds for a small charity called Young Dementia UK. And their role in this country is to help people below the age of 65 who have got dementia, some of those 40,000 people and their families. So that was one motivation. The second motivation was to try and keep using some of the skills that I've developed over the years, because so often with dementia, you lose those skills. And I'm aware of that, and I do experience that, so I'm very keen to try and retain some of those skills, and in fact to try and build upon them and make them even more so. And one way of doing that is through writing. The third thing is to try and challenge some of the stigma and stereotypes around this health condition, to show people what can be achieved, and it can be achieved with support. And one central theme throughout the book is the support that I've been able to receive over the past 7 or 8 years. And the best thing about having dementia has been the fabulous people I've met since. That's really been the only saving grace. And then the fourth reason I wrote the book was really to give people who read it hope, because that's hope for those who are affected by dementia, i.e. they've got the disease, or they live with people, or they know people who've got it, but also people of the younger generation who almost certainly will develop it in years to come. And to illustrate the fact that it isn't a death sentence, and it isn't an end. It's an end of a chapter, but not the end of the book. The message of the book is linked to what I've just said, really, that I would wish that the book gives people hope, and that it gives people information, it gives people encouragement, and maybe even some inspiration to A, live life to the full, and to live each day as it comes, which is vitally important, but also to have something to look forward to in the near future, and then to go out and seek to achieve that. And next, it really encourages people to look out for the support that is out there. It might not come and land in your lap, but it is there if you look for it and if you know where to look for it. And I hope this book will be a source of support for people. It is a postcode lottery. In Kent, we probably, if you express this as a league table of support, we're probably somewhere in the middle. So there are some parts of the country where support is far less than we have in Kent, but other parts of the country it's far more. Now that is wrong, and I wouldn't want things to be levelled downwards. I want things to be raised upwards. So where there are good practices of support, and where there are good programmes of interventions available to people, they should be there for everybody, not just because of where you live. And you need to remember as well that there's been no drug developed for dementia for 15 years that works. Now that is quite phenomenal. There's been various research projects taking place to try and address that, and there still are, and more funding is going into it, but it is pathetic the amount of money that's been invested in dementia research over the years. We're starting from a very low base, but things like the London Marathon, which attracted a lot of publicity around research for dementia, will help. and that is part of the campaign to raise £250 million to run a Dementia Research Institute in London. And this has come under the umbrella title of the Dementia Revolution, because in a sense, it should be a peaceful peaceful revolution in order to bring about change and to bring about positive change. Well, really, to live each day as it comes, to seek support, to find things that work for the person and to do them and enjoy them with somebody else. So often people strive for independence, which is great, but independence can be quite solitary and quite lonely. Better to strive for interdependence and to be able to maintain social networks, because I feel through that you've got the best chance of living well. Because any medication that is out there only deals with the symptoms. There is no medication to cure dementia. There's no medication to treat dementia. There's no medication to prevent dementia. So really it is about people which will do those things best of all.